So it's the weekend, and I was going through my subscribed YouTube channels and seeing what new and interesting stuff is there. And I noticed that Steve at Woodworking from Mere Mortals has challenged people to make animal theme projects and upload them for charity donations to makerscare.org. I'll put a link down below and a link to Steve's challenge video. Makers Care is an organization of makers and artists who are helping to improve the lives of people and make the world a better place through our fundraising efforts. So, this year's challenge is animals. So, since I don't really do woodworking and I'm not a sculptor or anything else, I remembered that I have this set of Prizer miniature sports figures, and in it is a horse and rider. So I think I will do those guys. Now this is going to be an interesting challenge for me, as I'm not the world's best painter. Matter of fact, I happen to be red-green colorblind, so painting is especially weird for me. But my wife assures me that a couple of the colors that I've picked out are in fact horse-ish colors, and I'm not sure whether I'll do the rider in the video or not, but there's the horsey. Let me zoom in on him a little bit here. So there's how he is on the sprue. Right side, left side. So I'll have to see how this guy comes out. I'm thinking that I'm going to do him mostly in this color here, which I'll get it on screen, which is called Territorial Beige, but who cares what the name from the factory is. It looks sort of like some of the colors of horses that I spotted online, and notice that a lot of horses will have a little red flash down the middle of their nose, so I'll use some of the, that's not red, that's white. A little white flash, red would be weird. And then a slightly darker mane and tail, so I'll mix a little bit of that in with either russet or burnt umber, I'm not quite sure. When I'm mixing them up, I'll check and see. And then the saddle and the saddle blanket. Most of the pictures that I found, the saddle blanket is, at least in formal equestrian, is often white, but I suppose it could be anything. And the saddle can be, well, probably black or super dark brown. Maybe a dark brown mixed with some black. We'll have to see. Just snip that, and I'm snipping it into the sprue a fair bit, so I know that I'm not going to knock a chunk off the horse. Park the rider aside, put him back in the box with all the other sports guys. Because this isn't about people, this is about animals. So now then, take an X-Acto blade. This is a fairly new one, but I'll give it a sharpen on my diamond hone here anyway. This isn't about me being cheap, although I am. This is actually about getting it even sharper than it comes from the factory. And I'll just clean up that little nubbin on the saddle. Now, Prizer was fairly smart when they were molding these, because that sprue mark is on the top of the saddle. Which means when we put a rider on it, which isn't going to happen right away, that's not going to happen in this video, but when I finally get around to putting the rider in it, or on it, it's not going to show at all. However, that's not a bad job of cleaning that up anyway. Now then, Mr. Horsey. I'm just going to take a closer look. I think he might have a molding mark on. Yeah, he does. There's a little molding mark right there on his leg. So I'll give that a little touch up. Normally, you wouldn't want to cut towards your fingers, like I am. Cut towards your chum, not your thumb, I believe was AVE's shop teacher's maxim. There's that. Even on camera, yeah, okay, good. That one, it's convex. The profile's sort of like a rugby ball or football. And just smooth that out a little bit. Now then, I'm going to bet that the other two legs have something similar. Yeah, they do. So, not sure, did it say on the box? No. So these are in the scale that I model in, which is HO scale, a model railroad scale, which in numbers that anybody else can understand is 1/87. So, this horse, when he's done, will be, you know, you can stack 87 of them on top of each other to get the height of a normal horse. So, there's those two bits cleaned up. Let's see how he sticks together. Huh. Not horrible. Once I've got them glued, I'm going to have to clean up the glue line a little bit. And I'll have to be careful when I'm gluing them to not get any fingerprints in the glue when I clamp it. A smart person would gather a clamp before they started into this. When you're working at this scale, clamps are often repurposed from other things. In this case, good old clothespin. So let's just dry fit him again. Clamp him up. Well, it's not too shabby. Those locating pins are actually, they're not square, they're just slightly trapezoidal, or actually no, truncated pyramid, I think is what that is. So the tighter you clamp it, the tighter they center up. Nice, okay. So, a little bit of glue. Standard tester's model glue, which is actually an methyl ethyl ketone based solvent type glue. And I think, let's put some up there, some on the locating pins. Okay. It's fairly light stuff, so it evaporates relatively quickly, and I'm smelling it already. Oh, sorry kids, don't do that. Okay. So that's him clamped in there. This is the point where time passes. That stuff sets up fairly quickly, but watching glue dry is only slightly less interesting than watching paint dry. So I'll spare you that and I'll come back in a while. Okay, that glue's dried a little bit. And now, something that I like to do anytime I'm painting these little guys is to perch them up on a pin, just so I've got a handle to paint them with. Normally I'll drill a hole in a foot or someplace convenient. And then when I put them on my model railroad, I just plant them into the foam using the pin. For Mr. Horsey though, since he's got 4 feet and 3 of them actually sit on the ground, but they're super duper skinny, as horses' legs are, and if I try and drill that up in there, it's going to just kill my horse. So I'm going to use my wee drill and just drill up his belly where it's never going to be visible in the final product. And I And I'll just glue my pin in there. Ah, sorry horse, that looks uncomfortable. And normally I would cut the head off the pin to put it up. And actually I think I might anyway, because that's tapered and that won't hold in the hole properly. So just chop that off, finger over it so that it doesn't launch into random locations and I never find it again. Put that in the garbage. Starting to get into tweezer territory here. Gonna go in there. Yes. Okay, and I don't know. Normally I would glue that in, but this thing, I got them far enough up in there and it's gonna come out eventually anyway. I have a painting handle on my horse. So we got here, there is a bit of a parting line where I glued them together. And let's zoom in on that a little bit so you can see it a little bit better. I think if it's going to focus. Is it going to focus? Or focusing? There. I think you can see that a little bit. So I'm going to touch that up. Easy zoom out. Sorry. Cheap camera. Do I want to try and file that or do I want to try and fill that? I think I want to try and fill that. Modeling putty, Squadron Green. It's basically a filler and it dries relatively hard. Squeeze a little bit out onto this bit of foam core here. Okay. That's a completely excessive amount, which is just fine. And like most of my stuff here, it's been sitting for decades not being used. But that's fine. Okay, now then. There's a bit of a cleft on his butt here. I'll fill that in. And again, if I get a little bit carried away, it's not a big deal because I'm going to file it down after. But maybe that has crudded up over the years. And in the middle there, I don't think I want to fill it in completely because there's a little bit of a sort of a cleft in the chest that I think it's very natural on a horse. I have to go back to the internet and find some more pictures because my memory is a little bit hazy. Now this is going to look really ugly and muddy and nasty, but I can always take some off later, and this isn't going to be the final surface coat. I don't know. That'll do. I'll let that dry and come back to it, I guess. Okay, I think that's dried long enough. Let's give him a little bit of a filing to even it all out. And I hope that the paint will cover that nicely and nobody will ever know I was there. The reason I'm using this convex file is just to get into the creases without leaving sharp edges like the square file would do. Sort of like that, where the neck blends into the chest. I'm going to give him a little bit of a cleft in the middle of his chest here. Not nearly as severe as that molding line was. Okay, knock the dust off him. There we go. I think Mr. Horse is ready to start painting. So for a brush, I've got an assortment of artist's brushes here. Some are old and gross, beat up like that one. I don't think I'll even use it. That one's got a bit of an angled tip on it. I might use that for some, that one for some larger areas. And which size is this one? It's very generic. That one's a little bit too broad. And for the finer areas, I use this one, which is a 10/0 or 10-0 brush. Comes to a nice fine point. And I think, but I'll use that for details. I'll save it for later. Put its little protective cover back on. And yeah, I think I'll start with these two for now. There's the little dip into the paint, and away we go. Now this is always challenging, doing it for the camera. Because normally I would want to get my face in as close as I can to my work. And also, I'm trying to keep my hand from blocking the camera like it was just there. So this is just a rough first coat here. It'll give me an idea of what I'm working with. I'm going to go back in later. These paints are absolutely nothing fancy or special. Matter of fact, most of them are craft paints from the dollar store. This isn't really a how-to video, although I suppose if you're new to painting miniature stuff, it's probably not a horrible introduction, although I don't claim to be a contest-quality painter. I'm just having fun here. Like I said, I am going to overcoat this tail later with a slightly darker color. A few other things are going to happen too. Anyways, I'm going to edit ahead a little bit. I'm going to just spin this around so I can see it. But there's no way I can do it properly on the video. Okay, there's the base coat. Essentially complete. I'll have to touch up any thin spots after that dries a little bit. I can see a few on the back conches there. One thing that's pretty much a constant about all painting projects is the thing that takes the longest is drying. So I'll pause and come back after that's dry. Okay, so I finished, in the previous scene, I finished the base coat of brown everywhere. Now, I've got a little tiny bit of white on my palette board here. And is the horse in focus? Not really. This is going to be a little bit of a trick. I'm using the second finest brush I have, and I'm just going to do that little white bit down the middle of his middle of his face that I've seen so many horses with. And I apologize that this is going to be hard for you to see because my hand's in the way, but there it is. I'm going to just go in a little bit closer and touch that up, but there that is. Okay, back with a little bit of black on my palette now. And 10-0 brush. And try and do this without getting my fingers too much in the shot. Oh boy. These details are getting to the point where I need to start getting right up tight to my face with the magnifier in order to do them. But there's just a really, really rough start. I can use my other colors because they're straight out of the bottle. They're not mixed. So I can use my other colors to touch up any places that I mess up. There, I've got the saddle roughly painted in. I've gotten a little bit thick down. Where am I? A little bit wide down here. And on the bottom, I got absolutely blotchy there. So I'm going to go back in with the base brown. And while I've got it on the brush, I'm also just going to do some light washes of it on places where the paint's kind of thin. So any place where I'm touching up the thin spots on him, I'm making my brush strokes lay in the same direction that the horse's hair would lie, just so that if the brush strokes remain visible, which it's quite possible that they will, then it's not going to be a big issue. So what I'm going for now is the mane and tail color, which on most of the horse pictures that I've found is a little bit darker than the standard body color. Not always, but in most cases it is a little touch darker. And again, paint strokes with the flow of the hair. Okay, that's getting a little bit blobby on there, and I'm starting to lose the detail of the hair. There, I think that looks pretty reasonable. The underside there, now then. The mane. This is going to be tricky, and I'm going to have to do it under extra magnification, which again is going to make it hard for you to see. There's the mane and tail, which I'm hoping on camera you can see are a little bit darker. Now, the part that I've been dreading. The finest details is of the bridle, the harness that's on the horse's head. Okay, for doing that fine harness work, I need something even finer than these brushes. So what I'm gonna do is just essentially make myself a pen, whittle myself a super fine point on a toothpick. I use that as a pen, essentially. So I'll just dip that in my black paint. Mark it on. Now this is something that, to get this done properly, I'm going to have this a few inches from my nose. I'm going to be looking over my glasses. I'm going to be squinting, and I'm going to be propping my elbows up on something. And I'm going to need to be in the light. And my hand is going to be in the way of the camera. There we go, finally. You can actually see what I'm doing. I can't see what I'm doing, but you can. So, I'm even shaky there because I was too far away from it and I didn't have myself propped up right. So, I can use my X-Acto knife to, as an eraser, to scrape a little bit of that stray paint away. I'm going to go back in with my toothpick and finish up, but I can't do this for the camera. Sorry, guys. Alright, so there he is. Got the harness done. Got the touched up places where I slipped. I said earlier I was going to use the X-Acto knife to scrape paint off if I got paint over paint. But of course that doesn't work with the acrylics on plastic. It just takes it right down to the base. So my eraser is basically a little bit more of whatever the paint was that got messed up. I just noticed. I'm not done yet. The hoofs shouldn't be the same color as the hair. They should be darker. I think I shall just use the black. Because black is not an uncommon color for a horse's hooves. Nope, that's too dark. So the brown in with the black. Get dark brown. Okay, let's try that. Much better. Okay, horsey. Okay. There we go. To me, that looks like a horse. An HL scale miniature horse. I'll just have to find a place to put him. And there we go. One horse. Outstanding in his field with a farmer. Just like a horse should be. Ready to go for a ride. So, thanks for watching. As I said earlier, this isn't really intended as a how-to or a tutorial, more of a just, I'm doing this, so I'll let you into my shop and you can watch over my shoulder. If you learn something, great. If you're a more experienced model or a painter than I am and you're laughing, well, at least you had a laugh, that's good too. Thanks for watching.